The main hunter, Erdal Soji, is in Korea now, and he told me to give this presentation, but this is his research. We're lucky to have Paul Shoemaker, is his support scientist, and he did all the work. So I'm just presenting. We're all at the ARS in Florence, South Carolina. We are about 2 hours and 15 minutes from here. So for this presentation, we're going to look at retrofitting the quick wash process to remove the sludge or the phosphorus from the sludge from lagoons. And what you see here is the typical manure management in the southeast USA, the anaerobic lagoon, where the waste is being flushed daily into the lagoons. And there is a storage and treatment for about 6 months retention time. And then the supernate is used for land application in what they call the spray fields. And also, from time to time, we take care of the lagoon sludge. Maybe once every 10 years, once every 15 years, so depending on the design of the lagoon, the sludge has to be taken out. And they use dredging, sludge dredging. Then the second step will be to remove quartz solids. There is an homogenization. And very typical is to use these huge geobags, where they're used for the watering. So in order to keep the sludge from escaping the bags, they're also using flocculated polymer injection and flocculation. And then the liquid goes, the separated liquid goes back into the lagoon, and the dry solids are removed from the farm once the bags are, the materials are dry. So typically, the sludge is then applied at agronomic rates according to the nutrient content. And to avoid the buildup of phosphorus in excess of the capacity of soils and crops to utilize that phosphorus, the watered sludge often is moved off the farm, because there is no space in the farm to put that phosphorus. So an alternative to the sludge management, the sludge transportation, is on-site extraction and recovery of the phosphorus in a concentrated form. And this is where the quick wash come into place. What is the quick wash process? The idea came from the white lupin. It's a plant. I remember this was about 15 years ago, and we were looking how this plant act. It's a plant that survives in soils with low phosphorus. What it does, it produces in the roots organic acids, so that you can extract, the plant can extract low levels of organic phosphorus from the soil. So what we did is to refine the concept into a new process to recover the phosphorus from sludges and also from poultry litter. So, the quick wash is a process for phosphorus recovery from waste streams, human waste, and also animal waste. It has two main components or units. One is the phosphorus extraction, and from there we produce a solid that has low phosphorus, because we track the phosphorus. And then there is a second step, that is the phosphorus precipitation. When we have the phosphorus in solution, it's precipitated, and there is when we get the concentrated phosphorus and calcium phosphate. The process is commercialized by renewable nutrients and an exclusive license from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. The people from Renewable Nutrients are here. Can you raise the hand? Okay, those are the directors of the company, Jeff Dawson and Mike Smith. So, as I told you before, there are two steps in the process. First, the waste is mixed with acid, and we release the phosphorus from a solid form into solvent form. Then we separate the solids, and the solids, depending how much phosphorus we take, we can change the N to phosphorus ratio, NP ratio, because the nitrogen stays. All we do is to remove the phosphorus. This is why we call it a quick wash, kind of a quick hydrolysis. So we can change the NP ratio to match the NP ratio of crops. Usually in manure, the NP ratio is about 2, and crops are 5 to 8. So we can do that change. Then the second step is adding lime, calcium hydroxide, and we add a little bit of flocculant, and this is anionic flocculant, which makes the process much better. And from there, we get the phosphorus precipitation and the watering of the phosphorus, and the and we obtain a concentrated phosphorus. So how does the process is retrofit into the common management? This is the four steps of sludge management using dredging and these geobags. So the first step of the quick wash, this is number one, is apply to the homogeneous sludge. One is put into, taken out of the lagoon. And then the second step of the process is add to the water as it come out of the geobags. Let me show you this a little more in detail. So we have the homogeneous sludge, and then we add acid, and this is the phosphorus extraction. The phosphorus from a solid form into a soluble form. And then the sludge with soluble phosphorus go through the geobags. And there we apply some polymer to retain the sludge as before. And then we have a solid with low phosphorus, and then an effluent that is charged with soluble phosphorus. And then we apply the second part of the process, that is the peer recovery with lime and flocculants, so that we recover the phosphorus in a concentrated form. This is the swine sludge characterization. As you see, it has a lot of solids, about 57 parts per million of total suspended solids. It's kind of a thick, well, I guess it's sludge, it's a thick material, and it smells like, it has an oily, like a mineral smell. It doesn't smell like manure. It's different, it's not manure, it's something else. But as you see, all the phosphorus is like 4,000 parts per million of phosphorus, and little in soluble form. So as it is, all the phosphorus is in a solid form, and this is where we try to solubilize this and then to separate from the carbon, and so we can get a high level, high grade phosphate. So there were three experiments that were done in the lab before the company went into the field to test the process in the recovery of phosphorus from sludges. The first experiment, the question is how much acid we need to add into the sludge to solubilize the phosphorus. So the experiment was simple. It's a 20-minute mixing with different rate of acid. And here in the graph, you have the different amount in grams of acid per cubic meter of sludge. And then what we do, we measure one thing is the pH, and that is in blue. In both graphs is in blue. And as we add more acid, the pH goes down between 8 and 3. And then as the material is being acidified, we can see the amount of soluble phosphate to be higher and higher and higher. Okay, and in the second graph, it's the same information, but it's in percentage. So about 95% of the soluble of the solid phosphorus was solubilized in this experiment. And so once you have that information, the second question is for the group, the second question for the group, we don't know, are commercial filter bags effective to trap and separate the acidified slash solids? So in this experiment, we use three filter bags, the 400 microns or 0.4 millimeters, that is the commercial CHIO bag, and then we use the 250 and 600. And then, so we acidify the slash, and we acidify the slash at three different pHs, from 3 to 5, and then it was sent to the bags. So we wanted to obtain is to retain the slash, but the soluble phosphorus to go through. And in this experiment, we were successful with all these bags. You can see here the percentage retained by the filter, 98%, 99%, and so. So this 400 micron bags is good for retaining the solids. Then another experiment was to test the precipitation of the phosphorus that has been solubilized. And in this situation, when they get to pH 3, we corrected the pH with lime at three pHs, 8, 9, and 10. And in order to do that, we apply different amounts of limes. And then what was evaluated was how much phosphorus was removed. And the data showed that in any case, pH 8, 9, and 10, there is not too much difference. So pH 8 will be appropriate to precipitate most of the phosphorus by applying lime. Another information in this slide is that we get a very high grade of P2O5, 30 to 35%. This is very good. So as a summary for the laboratory data, we have three pHs with acidification, and we find that the extraction is sensitive to the level of acidification. So how much acid you add change the solubilization from 50 to 83% in this case. And then once the phosphorus is in the soluble form, a pH of 8 was always effective to remove, to capture the phosphorus. Another piece of information in this table is that the effluent in any case contains very little phosphorus, less than 1%. So the last part of the presentation is about the pilot plant that Renewable Nutrient tested in a pig farm. The pilot plant that the parts of acidification and polymer addition, and also the part of precipitation and the watering of the phosphorus is mounted in a mobile trailer. And here you see the unit next to the swine lagoon where the sludge was being extracted and the watered. They use a kind of a SCADA system, and you see the two unit process to control the amount of acid, pH, and so forth. So the process is kind of automated. For the watering of the phosphorus sludge, they use a filter press. And in the two slides at the right, you can see the recovered phosphate product that is obtained with the process. So this was tested in the field, and what you see here is the results of that testing. You see the suspended solids before being added to the filtering bag, after filtering bag, and then after the filter press that removed the phosphate. And what you see suspended solids is that the bag retain very well the sludge solids. Then this is also good for the total phosphorus. The total phosphorus in a soluble form went through the bag, and that is represented into these two numbers. And then with the last step, it was knocked down and precipitated. So the system worked in the field as was predicted in the laboratory test. So this is a summary of the process efficiencies. And we're following the suspended solids and the total phosphorus in the percentage. We start with 100. And in the process, there are two splits of the phosphorus. You can follow where the phosphorus is going. The first split is in the bag. And you can see that most of the suspended solid, 98%, is retained by the bags, and little, 9% is kept there. All the phosphorus, or most of the phosphorus, 91%, goes through. And then it comes the second split in the process, and that is representing these two blue arrows. We apply land, go through the filter press, and then we obtain a cake that contain 90% of the initial phosphorus. And that I think is a very good performance. And of course the effluent contain little phosphorus and little solids, and that goes back into the lagoon as was planned. The last slide. The last slide is the analysis is what is obtaining the product. So two types of analysis were done. And the first one is an elemental analysis. I think this is an ICP analysis. Mm-hmm. And there you see that we have mostly calcium and phosphate. With the 30.5% P2O5 grade. Then the second type of analysis is the X-ray diffraction. What is nice about this analysis is we compare the product with two standards, calcite and amorphous calcium phosphate, and we were able to do a quantitative analysis with an XRD and try to see what kind of minerals are there. And in the bottom are the results. We have the product has 80% amorphous calcium phosphate and 20% calcite, that is the calcium carbonate. So that means that all the phosphorus, 100% of the phosphorus, is an amorphous phosphorus. So as the conclusion, the process, the quick wash, can extract and recover up to 90% of the phosphorus from a swine lagoon sludge. Believe me, there is a lot of phosphorus sitting down there after 10, 15 years of production. Most of the phosphorus is in the bottom of the lagoon, so this is kind of a gold mine there that is sitting in the bottom of the lagoons. In field tests, this is the pilot test that Renewable Nutrients conducted. They recover a phosphorus material with 30% P2O5, and again the process is commercialized by Renewable Nutrients and the exclusive license from the USDA, and the management of Renewable Nutrients is also here, so any business questions need to go there. And this is conclusion of the presentation.
We have about 3 minutes for questions, so feel free.
So I have a quick question on the geotubes. Do you see farmers trying to speed up that process, maybe using a belt press like you're doing in the pilot scale, at a full-scale farm level?
I will ask Chef Dawson to answer the question. They're asking other than what the bags instead of geo bags.
on the sludge removal instead of geotubes?
I think that's a better question, sir, to some of the farmers that actually do that. We were on a farm that happened to be using geotubes for the water. And it just kind of made sense to put the drip wash system in that process. It's also a pretty economical process. Look at the geotubes compared to the cost of dewatering machinery. You're not the same, you're two different ballparks. But I think that's a better question to ask to some of the farmers.
So that's in the room of the conference. So then the farmers delivered the sludge to the system.
That's right. And we've done the same trial at facilities in different locations in the country that didn't use those. So, it doesn't matter to us how we receive respirators.
Thank you.
Yeah, there was
we brought in the first stage of separation.
So the basic conclusion we did was a retrofit to some existing practice. This is what they have. They have two more units getting good wash and effective wash. But other than working the rice can be used.
Yeah, I'm not sure my relevant after that. I was wondering about the same thing, whether the water critical to the economic effectiveness of the process. I just want to also comment that in the process that we have for struvite, we have something similar. We have our struvite slurry to dewater, let drain water in filtering bags, like 1-ton bags. And we found, I don't have any data on this, but those bags, they're a plastic product, so they're kind of hydrophobic, and water doesn't want to pass through them very fast. But we found that if those bags are in contact with something water loving, wood or another cotton receptacle or something that it will like, it wicks it through, it actually pulls it through, speeds it up. So I don't know.
Okay, one last question.
I have a question about the solid you generate. So that the solid is have a low pH. Does it come back to a normal pH? Is that the production of ammonia in the solid will be enough to raise pH up to a normal range? Or do you need to do something to do the acidified solid before going to the land?
They are the kind of the pH there.
Yeah, the solid part.
Solid in
a bag. Is it a problem that the pH is not in a neutral range?
I don't think it's a concern that,
okay.
That the pH. In fact, it's good.
Yeah.
Because you can, because the lower pH, you kill pathogens. And then all of a sudden you have a classic problem. And that is especially critical when they're doing municipal, the water, quick wash municipal. You are getting a sludge with low pathogen because of the low pH. And that helped meet the class A standards, which changed the game in application for municipal. But it shouldn't be a problem from the agronomic point of view.